Good morning, everybody, or good evening, or whenever you're watching this again. This is Jason Jeffries for the Alliance Project, and I'm going to be giving you a little background information on these papers I'm going to be releasing. These are papers from physicists and astronomers that both were held very high positions in the U.S. Naval Observatory. I'm going to go ahead and pull up some images and go kind of through a slideshow and share the information as fluently and basically as smooth as possible. So hope you guys enjoy. And this is going to be a very, very important show if you want to learn about Nibiru, the Anunnaki, and the real science behind what's our origins, our story, I guess you could say. It all goes hand in hand with biblical and a lot of other religious texts from other cultures. So let's get right into it. So first we're going to go over the clues to the missing planets in our solar system. Planets. Okay. So there's obvious to physicists that they're, according to Bode's law, which we can go over if you'd like, but I just like referencing you to the point so it doesn't take too long. Look up Bode's law and then find it out. But you find out there's essentially set distances in almost masses that electromagnetic and a gravitational pull of our sun or a star will essentially create rings around the planets, around the sun, emanating out from it, that at different distances they have different masses, and they essentially can tell if a planet's supposed to be there, was supposed to be there, or is there. So for those of you who aren't familiar with Tom Van Flanderen or Robert Scott Harrington, they were both astronomers and physicists that worked for U.S. Naval Observatory, and they both came to reject the standard model of our solar system. Van Flanderen himself started to reject it gradually over time and basically realized that the standard model of how the origins of comets come into this from the Oort cloud was basically nonsense on their theories on it regarding just the origin of comets. So these papers that we're purchasing actually show the proof that the asteroid belt itself, not the Oort cloud, not where the comets come from, but the asteroid belt itself, is obviously the remnants of a super large planet. I believe it was 50 Earth masses, 50 times the size of the Earth. They called it Lucifer. They called it Tiamat. They called it Marduk. They called it Tiamat, Marduk, Lucifer. There's a couple other names, but those are the ones that I can remember. So we're just going to go with those ones. So essentially, he investigated the geological evidence from the asteroids, and just like I said, things like Bode's law and a couple other models, if you will. And they even did an algorithm, a predictable calculation on the trajectory of these things. And essentially could find out that there was more than one impact, and it was most likely the remnants of more than one planet, but not all of the second planet was destroyed, if that makes sense. It could have been a moon, and if you look at the Sumerian records, which I'll show you in a moment, it most likely was the moon. Moon of Nibiru. He essentially made a statistical computation of the origin of comets, and he found out that essentially from the trajectory of these comets that this planet, this missing planet where the asteroid belt is, would exploded at different points in history. Okay. Exploded planet, 50 times the size of the Earth, exploded. Okay. And they found out that it didn't happen just once, but at different times in history. The dates they derived were 55 million years ago for the original explosion, and then 3.2 million years ago. So that gives you a more realistic timeline of Tiamat when it was destroyed. And it coincides with the dinosaurs and the extinction of these dinosaurs and other animals, things like that. It almost was like this world was destroyed and the soil of our planet was made from this other planet, this Tiamat, this Marduk, Lucifer, however you want to look at it. This planet exploded, the remnants in a vacuum suck into a ball, and then it created the plate tectonics, which no other planet in our solar system has, showing it's almost like taking a bunch of Play-Doh, right, and sticking it together in a ball from separate little balls and not mending it or kneading it enough to make it one ball, if you will. It's still the puzzle pieces, the Play-Doh would fall off, it'd still be round, but there's tectonic, there's plates, because essentially in a vacuum, everything is pulled into a circle as tight as it can get. Centrifugal force, second law of motion, a lot of other things have to do with this, and a lot of mysteries that we don't understand, unless you go into unifying field theory and a lot more stuff like that. Essentially, if you want to think about that way, mass, something having mass, like, it's in a field. There's like a field, like, so light is just outside of the field of mass, if you will. It doesn't interact with this field, this layer of snow on the earth, if you will. And it skis across the top, so it moves faster. But if you had snowshoes on or boots, you'd be walking, trotting through that snow. You'd be denser. You'd be deeply interacting with that field. Say the field is snow itself. So if you have skis and you're skiing on top of it, you're moving rather fast. But if you interact deeply with this field, it slows you down, okay? That's where the mass comes from. So that's why I reject the idea of photons and things like that. I don't believe in that. I completely have a totally different understanding of how vibration and frequency and everything is kind of coherent with these waves. And essentially everything's a wave. A particle is only your sensory perception of a wave in your human state. If that makes sense. It is the matrix. The matrix is your mind. These tools that we decipher these waves with are essentially like a computer screen. We see binary coming at us and the computer makes something out of it. Well, the same thing. We get these wavelengths aiming at us and we get colors, shapes, textures. So I understand that much of it. So not to get too far off subject, but when you're talking about the binary code, it gets into real creepy detail, because then you can talk about the matrix alternate timelines, what people call the Mandela effect. Essentially, in the 1940s, I believe, they came up with binary code and a guy made it and or at least discovered the use of this number system and made it complex enough to have a coherent language, if you will, with our alphabet. And as scientists have used these very, very intense tools each year, every year we have a new satellite, a new tool, a new thing, a new tool on the satellites, new information, new data to compute and punch into these quantum computers and regular computers. And essentially, it changes us, the way we think, but also our understanding. But the point is, our information that we're receiving from these satellites and all these instruments is showing us that it is rich, that the universe itself is rich with computer code, literally computer code that was invented in the 40s. I guess you could say discovered is a better way to put it, but invented, we created it at that point. We found that this, you know, the language of the universe is numbers, and it's simple. It's off or on. It's almost like a logic processor. It's yes or no. Is this true or false? The screen is black. False. The screen is white. True. you know, something like that, the aspect, that's how a computer thinks, and that's how computational errors and things like that, being true or false, can make a computer crash, because its logic processor fails and has no way of comprehending the mistake. It just says it's true or false, and in that reality, it's real, and at that time, it's real for the computer, at least. So what people don't understand mostly is that computers are nothing but an alignment of crystals. It's nothing more. It's an alignment of quartz crystals. And those are there's other crystals too. But it's the alignment of crystals interplaying with the circuit and has memory. The amount of processor and memory is doubling each processor we make. Essentially just tiny little quartz crystals. So that's why a lot of these indigo children and people that are in touch with themselves and going through this awakening, especially the younger generations from the 80s up, I guess you could say, have a special relationship with these computers. They understand how it works before most people do, and kind of sync up with them. It's second nature. The point of this being is for the people that think like crystals and quartz and things like that are woo-woo crap and it's metaphysics, and it's not really, it isn't. It's a quartz crystal, your watch you have that says quartz on it is literally a cord, an electrical current, a wire wrapped around a quartz crystal. And the quartz is a pulse, like a heartbeat. It's called piezoelectricity. And essentially, I believe they pulsate at 7.28 hertz. Hertz being how many ups and downs in a second. So it goes up and down 7.28 times in a second, meaning your heart beats just kind of like that. It's the same aspect. It does that almost 8 times in a second. And because of that, being so in touch with this fabric of reality that we exist in, they can set watches off of it. So they make quartz crystals watches, and the computers or device you're watching me on right now would not be possible without the power of quartz crystal. Okay. I don't want to get too far into it, but silicon, things like that, they're most likely, carbon isn't the essential building block for life. We completely believe, because you have, say this is the carbon molecule. You go on to the periodic table of elements, essentially, like silicon is just one octave above and below. It's like you add one piece of the building block to that. So essentially carbon, it's almost as the base molecule, right? So there exists on this planet, not just out there in the universe, creatures that don't have carbon in their body, they have silicon. So it's very possible that on other planets that this transhumanism robot fucking transformer type silicon based, not carbon based, life forms exist. And it's probably in the idea that they're more like insects. They could be humanoid, but I'm saying the way they look or produce themselves. Not to get too far off, like I said, but you can get into the physics of this matrix that's all around us, essentially this binary code that's coming from the universe that's literally computer. It's not like computer code, it is computer code. Okay, so we're pulling this information all around us, and you realize that what they're doing with quantum computing, and all they need is somebody to prove that quantum computing could change a timeline and create essentially not what I'd call an alternate universe, but possibly an alternate timeline in an alternate reality for maybe not all of us, but for some of us. And that's theoretical, of course, but we're getting into the point of a lot of timeline shifting and changing. So think of it as a black hole, right? We know at the center of universes, or the galaxies, probably the universe as well, are black holes. Black holes are dead stars, usually like a neutron star or something that was a supernova, giant, super giant, exploded, blam, sucked back in. And now it's essentially got so much of a gravitational effect that it is affecting space and time curvature, if you will. It'd be like putting a ball on a napkin. Okay, the napkin being space and time, one direction space, one direction's time. When you put a pool ball on there, the napkin bends. Right? And that is what's happening. There's so much, essentially, mass and energy in one spot, because we understand there's an energy-mass relation equals mc squared. It can actually curve it to one singularity point. But if we know nothing can be created or destroyed, then a child would ask this question. Where does it go? Where does all this matter? If light cannot escape this, meaning you cannot even see light coming out of this because it is pulling the vibrations of light into it, then you can see why they're calling it a hole. But on the other side, people believe, and I believe, that there's almost like a birth canal or a umbilical cord, if you will, coming from this black hole out to what we call a white hole. And that sounds to me like the Big Bang. It sounds like, right, in these white holes, they're ever expanding and they're constantly expanding, getting larger and shooting up mass to kind of orientate themselves with this mass that's coming in. So it's ever expanding. It's almost, like I said, the Big Bang. And when you look into quantum computing and these binary codes and black holes, things like that, you understand that, all right, all the mass is being pushed in there. Eventually, if you push it like the timeline long enough forward, everything in this known universe of the multiverse is what I'd call it, universe being a bubble. Essentially, it's like a bubble of soap. All right, and the soap bubble is expanding outward. And we thought that it was slowing down at one point, but it's now found out that it's actually expanding so fast and rapidly that it could actually cause a collapse or a pop, if you will. But that's only one bubble in the fabric of what we call the multiverse. And the multiverse is the idea that there's many of these bubbles that we call universes all around us in foam of what we'd call the multiverse. And inside those bubbles are kind of different realities. And how you could look at that is, even with the Large Hadron Collider, when they collapse this thing, they're looking kind of for that umbilical cord, if you will, the moment of conception, but to the alternate reality, right? This alternate timeline. And it's only, okay, how you could do it with quantum computing without getting too far off the subject. Just think of this. You could run a scenario like, Pokemon Go, okay? All those kids get that. It's a very big thing in pop culture. So they don't release it. They don't tell anybody they're going to release it. And they type in every known aspect of this reality into these quantum computers. And they have it predict the future, right? Just say compute, run a timeline, and see where this takes us, right? It takes us to a certain point. So they have the numbers of how reality would be if they did not release this, all right? At the same time, they're studying, developing, and then planning to release after that date. As they release, they can type and crunch the numbers into the quantum computer and have a predicted outcome. And then they can see how just introducing something small like Pokemon Go, having this person and that person just walking around town or being in a specific spot at a specific time, and having this multiplied by millions can actually change the timeline of the entire existence. Essentially, that quantum computer is creating an alternate reality based on computations that are faster than light, if you will. They don't work the way our normal computers work. But know that it's just like when you think about Pong. Pong was the game in the 70s. Now we have a virtual reality and motion sensing. We have a lot of the experience has grown a lot. Now, if we can do that in 30 years, that means at any rate of improvement, eventually video games will not be able to, you will not be able to tell them away from reality. Okay. And that's any rate of improvement over, I mean, even if it took a million years, at this rate, it'd take like 100. But even over a course of a million years, you play it out the same way. Eventually, video games will be just like virtual reality. It's almost as if something has hijacked nature, if you will, and controlled us through this matrix of entrapment of realities because of us not having the ability to see beyond, not the event horizon, but to see beyond the veil that they cloak around us. All right, and as we find out more and more scientifically and evolve as a species, we start learning and waking up to this bullshit that they're essentially feeding us. And once you realize we're an antenna, we're not like it's like a radio. It's like saying the radio signal comes from within the radio. It's crazy. It's crazy to say that the radio signal is inside the radio. It's actually picking up on it. It's an antenna. And it's crazy to say that all the other channels don't exist just because you're tuned into that certain frequency. That's the idea of dimensions. Once you tune into a frequency, a new frequency, a higher frequency, you're tuned into that information, and the other ones kind of fade away. They're not relevant to you. Okay, you phase in, phase out, just like a radio. Okay, so it's your antenna. Once you start realizing that it's literally like a grand simulation all around us, and it's literally the top scientists in the world will tell you that our universe having a physical, actual, like the reality that we're in being like real in a sense is a 1 in a billion. 1 in a billion. It might be 8 billion by now, but it was 1 in a billion last time I checked that this reality, that they can prove that this reality is not some kind of simulation. So for the people thinking about those wormholes and things like that, and Mandela effect and things like that, it's not to say that you don't have changes that affected you in your life, but sometimes maybe these changes they do don't affect everybody or affect others, or maybe some people can see through the veil, if you will, and they only get what really happened. They don't get this predictive, that the predictive things don't really affect them because they're living in the now. But that's a little off subject, I know, but it all ties together. So there's the timeline, and let's get back to what I was saying. So 55 million years ago and 3.2 million years ago. Now, if you look that up, you'll actually see some pretty major events happening with extinction level events and also fossil records. Lucy, for instance. And the dinosaurs, things like that. Trying to pick up the background because I know I talked a lot in between. Don't want to lose you guys because I seem to talk in circles sometimes, but it's only to connect the cycle, full cycle, and get back to the reference point that we were while setting a context. Okay. I understand I'm not a professional speaker, but I've come a long way, and you can basically listen or not. It's just I'm here to, I get these burnings to share this information. I'm led through to what I'm supposed to research and find, and as I listen to the guides, I guess you could say the spirit guides, I'm pulled to things. And then once I get drawn into that, I have this overwhelming fucking fire that has to share. I have to talk. I have to tell people. I have to share it. And then once I do, the weight is lifted. It's just so much to say and share and think about, but it's like a download, essentially. And you're led to where to research, what to look up at. And if you don't have the proper understanding or contextual understanding of what you're talking about or what you're being led to, you have to come to new understanding to fully understand the concept. So not understanding something is key. You have to go look back at that. But 3.2 billion, 55 billion. Or wait, 3.2 million, and then 55 million. That's when the planet exploded through this computational simulation from the known trajectories of the asteroids and planets, comets, a lot of other things. But like I said, these are the lead astronomers, observers, and physicists at the U.S. Naval Observatory. To further correlate this, if you go into the Sumerian texts or the ancient Vedic texts, the Hindu traditions, you will learn that these dates that I just gave you pop out as dates of major cataclysms. In these papers that Thomas Van Flandern and Robert Scott Harrington made after coming to these computations and epiphanies, if you will, revelation, they realized that it didn't look natural in the sense of how things work. He even went as far as to say possibly intentional, like a Death Star, just something destroyed this planet, okay? And it wasn't like not thought of, it was intentionally done. So he doesn't really explore to go into that, but because of his job and his credentials, but he does drop that in that hint. And like I said, he said it was intentional. So naturally, we all think of, you go back to the Sumerians and Egyptians, because they're full of these Star Wars or cosmic wars, or these wars between the gods and space, and these cosmic chess games, if you will, these giant wars that created humanity and humanity rose out of. Some even go as far as to tell you the technologies they used to fight these wars. If you look at it, they think that essentially this war came between people that at least had base set up on the Earth, the Moon, Mars, the missing planet, and of course the moons of Saturn. So some archaeologists that were familiar with basically the Vedas, the Vedic texts, the Hindu traditions, wrote a book called Forbidden Archaeology. Recommend people to read that. They did their homework. Correlates with all this information that I'm giving you. They go over a lot of archaeology digs and things like that, finds that they made that are either suppressed or thrown away, discarded, and not talked about because they don't fit into the timeline that they produce to us, the timeline they give us. And because of that, they have to lie or cover their tracks, so they hide things, okay? We found metallic spheres from South Africa that have three parallel grooves, essentially, that go around its equator. And they've been found in, like, mineral deposits, definitely handcrafted or crafted at least some way. But that was, I think it was 2.8 billion years old. I think that's how old it was the year they gave us. But this book goes over all these artifacts, essentially, that were obviously made by some kind of intelligent form in a time that was way before anything that we can comprehend or understand from just a standard model of understanding and teaching. You could say that these things are, the artifacts are occurring in what they'd call a geological strata. And it's showing that there's intelligence, there's coins, tools, batteries. I mean, things that are just mind-blowing, okay? Found, you know, in like 114 feet down. Different things, there are different mineral deposits. And all these surveys from the geological surveys show you that it's like 2.8 million years old, billion years old. They literally, because the numbers go from like 50,000 to like last year to like billions of years ago, okay? So if it wasn't humanity that did it, if it wasn't us, then it was a precursor to us, some race that created us. Maybe the angels, right? Or the Anunnaki, there you go, whatever, the watchers, whatever you want to call them. I'm sure they got a thousand names, and I don't want to get into like arguments of that, but it could definitely be a progenitor or precursor to humanity if it's not humanity itself creating these things all those times and years, all those years ago when we essentially didn't even know humans existed. This book, again, Forbidden Archaeology, is loaded with artifacts that outdate, they're man-made artifacts that completely outdate humanity in our standardized model. So there's no, we don't even, how would you find like It'd be like finding a microwave. Okay? That's like older than people. Like, you know, so dinosaurs were building microwaves and shit? No. It's not what it was. They're hiding things. And they're hiding it because, essentially, they're the ones that were in this war. They were the ones fighting. They were the ones creating. They were the ones hiding themselves, okay? And that's why I believe Thoth leads some of us down these certain paths to read certain books and certain teachings, because he knew and he knows that we couldn't expose them by ourselves. You look at people like David Icke. Look at all the slack and flack he gets. I mean, there's some of his stuff he makes excellent points on, and he does really great job, really great work. And there's other stuff that he actually borrows theories from and ties them to things that just aren't true. I mean, it's maybe one person's interpretation. It doesn't make him wrong or a liar, shill, but it does make him wrong in the sense that other people have a different interpretation. The same thing in the artifacts that he's using or tying to, you know, let's say Saturn, obviously can be studied further and see that not all of them go back to Saturn and lizard people, right? For instance, the Dogons, they were dolphins, not lizards, reptilians. When they're talking about these things that came to teach them, it was dolphins. If you look really deep into it, you see the signs of the zodiac. Pisces, Jesus' symbol. Jesus was actually known as the dolphin at one time. And it's crazy. The whole that means like Pisces originally was probably a dolphin, not just like a regular fish. And it goes into deep things. Cultures all around the world seem to have these ties with these things. And then they have a tie back to the Pleiades, which is even more amazing, seven sisters, as we call them. Don't want to jump off test, so give me a minute. All right, but essentially the book makes a case that something or someone created these things millions of years ago, and if it wasn't man, then it was a progenitor to man. It was the Anunnaki or something along that lines, just as the Sumerian texts tell us, and Egyptian texts. And the Vedic text, and basically every text ever, even the Bible, the Torah, everything. Heaven's gate, right? Gate to the heavens. Now, for all these flat earthers out there, I have to explain what they were talking about. And the same thing is dimensions. They essentially look at the Viking traditions, and that's the easiest way to understand. They have the underworld, the middle earth, and then they have, you know, the higher realms. Valhalla, right? And they had a rainbow bridge that gated you to heaven. Rainbow, light speed, light. They're talking about raising dimensions, going through the rainbow bridge. Essentially, you're becoming a light body in heaven, where you can go down to this denser, heavy reality that's below the earth, right? Not below, above, as above, so below. It's a dimension thing. When they're talking about the world being flat, they're talking in a sense that they were giving you dimensions, right? You had the realm below. And then you had the realm above, essentially. So just think that we'll add a couple lines to give you containment. We'll make these, we'll call these dimensional barriers. All right, so anyways, let's see if I can just draw. Earth realm. Okay, so here's Earth. Flat. They're talking about planes, dimensions, and I apologize for anybody who thinks I'm being smug, but you can just, it's obvious the world's not flat, and that's regression. The second law of motion, inertia, centrifugal force, a bubble and a level. Looking at the moon under the equator, the moon's always upside down in Australia. Have your buddy anywhere below the equator, take a picture. Have another flat earther go down that's below the equator. Take a picture of the moon, you take a picture of the moon, and explain to me why the moon's upside down from their perspective compared to yours. Okay. Measure a distance between a known landmark. Get the actual known elevation of the landmark. Go back as far as you think you want to go, as long as you can still see it. Get your elevation there. Accurately get your elevation. Account for that distance, and then allow for the elevation. And it'll show you that just because you see the landmark, it doesn't mean anything. All right. If the world was flat, you should be able to see everything below that landmark as well. Okay? You can't. You're only seeing partial parts of the landmark. Because as you add the elevation of the two objects into your equation, it shows you that the Earth is curved and allows for this curvature. So anybody that's doing that simple math and saying, oh, I can prove flat Earth, no, you can't. Explain to me how a bubble level works, just a level. Explain that, okay? Explain how a compass works. Can you? Explain how everything, you're literally that ignorant to think that everything revolves around you in this whole entire fucking universe. And you're watching these round things revolve and saying that they're moving. You have the idea and the concept to say that, but you don't have the understanding to say that you're on a ball like them and you're not the center of the universe. Just understand that, like, these are dimensional teachings. I think they were getting things through to people through an interpretation. So as your vibration raises, there's a frequency of Earth, right? As you go to a higher frequency up here, and a denser frequency down here, you know, that's what they were calling hell, a denser reality, and it would be more miserable. It would be a heavier feeling, right? It would be your frequency of what Earth is, essentially a lower frequency than that would be, imagine anything that you're suffering or going through on this plane of existence, and being worse, being about like that for your natural state. So that's why when they're talking about reincarnation, things like that of the soul, if the soul is on a certain frequency or vibration, it would go to that dimension, okay, until it rose its frequency to be compatible with the next dimension, such as reincarnation on Earth or to the planes of heaven. They're just barriers. They're talking about a rainbow bridge, essentially, between Earth and here. So as you become a light body, a rainbow bridge, you cross the rainbow bridge, Roy G. Biv, light, okay, broken up as through a prism, crystals again, right? You understand that you'd be at a higher frequency, so you'd be a higher dimension, and they're talking about dimensions essentially being stacked, okay? And the only thing connecting these dimensions is gravity. So something from a higher dimension could look down into your dimension through essentially what we call gravity lens. Okay? Same thing they're trying to do with CERN and a lot of the senses. Not always, but that's what they're doing. They're trying to essentially recreate alternate little fucking universes, just like I said, little timelines, little black holes, and chase the umbilical cord, and they're chasing it back to here. Oh, wow, we created that. But you got to think that's just a partial, it's such a small, like the lifespan of this tiny little universes, like microseconds, nanoseconds. They are for sure trying to advance humanity in their understanding and science, but I believe that they already had this science. They're just trying to rebuild stargates. I completely believe that. If you look at the technology, you understand that there was this technology. As they went through the war, they lost some of the technology, a lot of it, and had to rebuild back because they're essentially quarantined here. The other faction locked them here, quarantined them onto Earth, okay? So you can't go travel and go get your technology from your home world or recruit people. You can't do this. You're trapped here, okay? You're quarantined here. Now you have to figure out how to get past the Stargate, the moon, the lock of the earth, the souls don't go into the light. That essentially is because, like I said, they're trapped here. So they're using us to recreate technologies that they already had. Cycles. That's the cycle, a rising of civilization, a gradual decline, and a rising of civilization. It goes through cycles. And a lot of it has to do with the procession. And that's why that makes me think that there's a physical, actual body involved in this, because the timeline alone is in cycles, and at halfway point to the cycle, there's cataclysms, about 13,000 years. At least energy cataclysms where resonance and frequency, things like that, are vibrating to the point it exploded the cornerstones and topstones off the pyramids, blew the Abu Rawash pyramid completely off. There is nothing there. All the blocks are there. They said they were quarried, but the blocks are there. So why would people quarry the stones and leave them there? Okay, that's a fucking lie. Sorry, I get excited. The Egyptologists are completely making a huge cover-up. The famous hieroglyph where it shows the tank, the helicopter, and the land speeder from Star Wars. Let me pull that up for you. But the you guys know that hieroglyph, I'm sure. Okay, so here's the cosmic wars. We got paintings of these battles from the heavens, right? And just as the new Superman said, Lex Luthor wanted to flip the painting. He said, we think the demons come from below us, down in the earth. But we couldn't be more wrong. We know that they come from the sky. And they're talking about these attackers, these people, that essentially, if you're coming here from to this planet, you have to come from above, from the sky, you know. That's the only way. That's the door. That's how you get here. So and there's all throughout history, there's these cosmic paintings of these wars, galactic wars, things like that. Just boom! Okay? For instance, Marduk. Marduk, I believe, is destroying Tiamat here. I believe this is Nibiru, essentially, attacking Tiamat, Marduk, Lucifer. So they do it in this sense because they were, not only were they giving you a pictogram to share, but they were actually giving you context, like this planet and its affiliates, and their agenda was attacking this planet, their affiliates and their agenda, led by these people. Not that the planet was a lizard and this planet was a man in the literal sense, okay? They named them after them, and they use the stars to tell stories in astrology. Things like that, that was all woven, but there was very much truth to what they were saying. They had planets that were assigned to the deities and certain parts of the zodiacs and energies, essentially, that they were associated with the different gods, if you will. And what I want to do is show you. All All right, so we'll get to these ones. All right, so they actually cemented over this. Mortar fell off the wall one day, and that's how they found these. Okay. It's a helicopter, obviously. A spaceship dropping bombs, and like a land speeder. They're very obvious. This looks like a tank. I mean, it looks like something dropping a bomb. This is literal translations. They were giving you pictographs. And they say it's because, oh, this guy chiseled over this guy's name. Bullshit. I don't give a fuck. You can encrypt it and put two different hieroglyphs on there all you want. That's fine and dandy. I don't care what you say about that. No, not happening. Don't care. Period. Okay? Because anybody could go in there with the chisel afterwards and add, they'll say they lay over these two hieroglyphs and then they chisel out little parts of it to make it fit their story, okay? And then they cement over the fucking thing in the first place. They don't want people to see it. They're told, tour guides are told not to show these, okay? It's obvious to me, anyways, that they were telling us about this war. Evidence is everywhere. Point being is the evidence shows that somebody had to have been here to create these things. Whether if they were aliens, a human-like race, humans, or human-like entities from out there, or alien-like entities, we don't know, but the evidence is there. Evidence points to that they probably had genetics like us. That's probably where our genetics came from. Okay. Period. You can't have artifacts exist without somebody there to create them. These are obviously man-made or humanoid-made, we'll say. Artifacts that don't fit the standard model of what human evolution says. One famous example was these metal tubes that they found in France. They're like square-shaped metal tubes. An archaeological dig in France, it dated them to 65 million years ago. 65 million years ago. Point being, there was some kind of people present that had access to some kind of technology that allowed them to have the ability to do some of these things, like create metal square tubing.
The idea of a cosmic war being fought at those particular time periods begins to take on a little more plausibility.
So it proves that something had to be there at that time, and it gives more credence to this cosmic war taking place at those times, like the Hindu and Vedic and Egyptian Sumerian culture said that was going on, when you start finding artifacts that correlate with it that are suppressed. Okay, suppressed artifacts, because why are they suppressed? Why do they hide this information? They do that because they are the ones that won the war. Not maybe the whole entire war. They were quarantined here, obviously. But battle, they won the battle. They won battlefield Earth. They were here. They won. They were the victors. They got to go in and collect whatever was here. And now they're stuck here, essentially. We're the slaves to them. And if man knew of this forbidden knowledge, just as I've told you in other shows, about the forbidden knowledge being the truth about man's origins, we would revolt. There'd be blood running in the fucking streets. Nobody would stand for it. 99% of us being unarmed could take on the 1% with the most advanced weaponry you'd want, unless they completely destroy the planet. And that's about the only way you could do it. I don't see them doing that. Kind of like throwing the baby out with the bathwater. They fought to control us for this long because they want slaves. They want something. Obviously, there's an agenda that we are filling that they couldn't fill because they didn't have the manpower, the man hours, the timeline given to them to create, to finish the job they needed to do to save their race, or whatever part of the agenda is, could not be done without slaves. So they created humanity. Essentially, I mean, you got to be thankful, but it's a blessing and a curse at the same time, because we were evolved faster because of our DNA, souls, things like that started to come into this matrix of your body and like kind of go through the Stargate, if you will, into the incarnation into your body. And we're in these advanced bodies. We don't have any memory of, like most species, the instincts, things passed on through the DNA, understands these advanced concepts of your body and just everything. It's something that we don't understand as if we've forgotten them. And it's amazing. It really is that to go through this, as I told you, we kind of were like memory wiped there back about 13,000 years ago during Atlantis times and things like that. It was essentially like erasing software on your computer, like starting. You got the computer, you have this advanced body, but there's no software on it to make it run. So you just have a brick, essentially. Most people are like bricks. They don't understand their body. They don't understand their self. They don't understand the spiritual, physical, emotional, or mental aspects of any of it. Then there's the rest of us that are slowly seeing these threads connected through everything, weaving the universe together. But without a fact, without a doubt, there's evidence out there. Archaeology finds, digs, and archaeological evidence that left behind to prove it, back up what the Vedics, the Hindu traditions, and what the Sumerian accounts said. We had a Canadian astronomer that could predict the orbits of planets, but not only that, he could predict the mass of the planets. The size of the planet that he predicted should have been where the asteroid belt is, according to Bode's law, was of about the same or approximate mass of planet Saturn. The astronomers at the time called this missing planet Tiamat, Marduk, Lucifer. At the time, they called it Krypton because, well, there's a lot to get there. If you read into the Superman comics or even watch the new Superman movies, you see that they were essentially the Anunnaki on their home planet. They were seeding humanity out through the galaxy, out through the universe. And on their planet, it was illegal to have natural birth. They did it through test tubes. The woman would, you know, they would still use their eggs and sperm, but it was coded. The children were coded. And when he came here, their planet was loaded with what they called kryptonite. So they had to, their bodies just built a natural like immunity to it in their atmosphere and their sun, right? They came to, when they sent him here, our sun was more intense. So the sun gave him an awakening of energy and he started seeing in the X-ray, gamma ray, laser spectrum. He was looking through all spectrums. It was driving him insane because he was Superman. He was here. The sun gave him his power. He was normal on Krypton. But here, the sun's radiation gave him intense abilities. Okay. And he was seeing through things like that. But essentially, their planet destroyed itself in this great cosmic war. And Superman was sent here by his parents. Landed here. And he was the last of the original race that created all of humanity throughout the universe. Very weird and very cryptic message about Krypton. I found you guys a cool little image to share. Pull this up. There you go. Here's the old map of Krypton, and I even had the Arctic and the Antarctic comet. Kind of like showing you like the Pangaea. The old world, new world stuff, like the separations of the oceans, Atlantean continents, like coral reef growing, things like that, kind of like the story. But supposedly this planet Tiamat, Lucifer, Krypton, whatever you want to call it, was a water-bearing table. And if you look at the Enuma Elish, it tells you this same story that we're talking right now. And they talk about this battle between these planets and this war between the two deities, Marduk, which was Nibiru, and Tiamat, which is now the asteroid belt series and a couple other things. I've heard Joe Gilbrizard and a bunch of other people give the date on this of, like, I don't know. Anything that's within, like, a couple thousand years is ridiculous. It's it was about, I think, 3.2 million years ago when this thing was, the evidence lies there that essentially it was the truth. You can't, like, a lot of the stuff out there is bullshit because it's based on religious doctrines instead of science. I'm giving you straight science, so I hope you understand that. Let's get right back into it. All the texts say this was a water-bearing, life-bearing planet, even a planet full of dragons and things like that. We postulate or speculate that this was, there was intelligent life there, and it was causing problems, essentially. It's probably where these, the original rebellion, this, the Anunnaki had these two factions, right? They're battling the fallen angels, right? And they probably destroyed Tiamat in a nuclear war, okay? And they most likely kind of made like a planet prison, if you will, out of the remnants to keep light bodies, souls trapped here so that they couldn't escape by just chance that they didn't destroy them, that they would be at the next, kind of like the next door neighbor's house, right? And then you look at Mars and all that, and like the, learn about how they destroyed their environment with a synthetic Merkaba, and now they're doing the shit here. I mean, you look around and it's there, the evidence is there, it's in a lot of the ancient texts, like even the Torah itself says that they came from space, okay? So that was one of the two races that intermixed with the Lemurians being the original humans created by the priests. The Anunnaki became and lived amongst these people in the Atlantean times. The ascension process was probably running rampant at that point because the gods, if you will, are living beside you, and you get to learn a lot more. And firsthand knowledge, and the original civilization was built on creation. So you understand that. You understand they had the right idea, and we need to go back to our roots, if anything. Be thankful and don't be spoiled little fucks. I mean, we'd be monkeys if it weren't for this genetic engineering that went on. So just be glad you're not like living in the fucking woods, like sniffing your butt and being a monkey. Okay? Like, it was beneficial to you, sped up your timeline. Now you're an advanced creature that all they did was kind of skip ahead, right? That's all. So you have to take it as a curse and a gift, blessing and in disguise, if you will, and just enjoy what we've been given. Learn how to use it. Learn how to pass on what you know. Just like any single-celled organism does, its main goal and the goal of DNA itself is to pass on the vital information to the next generation so that nothing's lost and there's always a steadily step up to the next. You're always supposed to be better than your parent generation. And that's not a mean thing. You're supposed to be. It's that means they achieve what their fucking essential purpose here. Okay. So please enjoy and don't, I know I'm talking in circles, but I'm giving you a very in-depth background for these papers I'm about to release. I want people to understand. I don't want miss anything. I just want the truth to be shared, and I want people to understand. I want people like Astronomy Live to go ahead and debunk this shit, buddy. Because you're an astronomer, an amateur astronomer. You're not fucking getting paid by the U.S. Naval Observatory to fucking be the top paid astronomer in the world or the leader of that organization. No, that is a professional, okay? That's somebody I'll listen to. They have a passion for the stars. It's their job. And they're not letting the government tell them shit because they are the authority. If their information is suppressed or they get killed, that's different. But they're not letting anybody tell them shit because they know they are the ones. So it offends me when people try to debunk it because of the bullshit that's out there. That's why you're debunking it. You're looking at the bullshit. Look at the facts. Chase the facts. Find the facts. And you can see that it's not bullshit. Whether or not it's like hurtling towards us, or you can always see it behind the sun, or even if it's going to see us in the next 500 fucking years, who knows? But the aspect of it being real, that's out of the question. All I'm here is to kind of find the story, find our creation, share our story, learn as much as I can, and share as much as I learn. And that's it. I hope you guys are enjoying this process that we're going through. And I hope that my breakdowns give you an essential piece of the puzzle to help you break it all down for yourself. Okay, because there's a lot of disinformation out there. So it's a water-bearing planet. It's about 50 Earth mass. It's not the mass of Saturn, we'll say. There's the postulation that these astronomers, not just one, many, gave for the size of the planet that should be there. And if that's the case, since it was solid and a water-bearing planet, that would mean there'd be higher oxygen levels and more of increased gravity, requiring them to have larger skeletons, be larger people, the giants, planet of the giants. Think about that. So then the question is, are there any proofs of this? So we look and see if there are any giant skeletal remains, because the Bible talks about it. The Sumerian texts talk about it. The Vedics talk about it. That all these cultures talk about these giants. All the stories say the same thing, that these angels came down and populated with earth women. Whether if they did it genetically or they actually made love is different, because they talk about immaculate conception a lot, which means, sounds to me, is that these angels, if you will, the Anunnaki, they were impregnating the women through scientific means, and they weren't having sex with them. And that's why it was an immaculate conception, or the people completely were astonished that there was a child, right? Or think about Christ born, or that story of immaculate conceptions. But they all say the same thing. They're creating large offspring between these two races. Something that we call the Nephilim. David and Goliath, right? That same story. He was a Nephilim. One of the things I was talking about, Gerald Clark, about it's the Sumerian text called The Exploits of Ninurta. Now, if people want to say that this stuff's mythology, then this one will kind of maybe change your mind. It's really odd mythology, if it's mythology, because it's kind of like a bureaucratic fucking report of the victors of this war going in to the settlement and taking and acquiring and taking inventory on the technology and the stuff that they acquired from winning this war. Okay? It's like when the Allies won, they went through and made, oh, we got their nukes, we got this missile silo, we got their tanks, we got this, that, and the other. They took the inventory from the other people, the technology. They got to see what they were building, investigating, experimenting on, what they didn't hide or destroy anyways. And the technologies that they used in the war, essentially. So they got to acquire all the remnants of it. So if you could tell me why they'd make a mythological story about some fucking dry inventory fucking lists done by like bureaucrats, then be my guest. I don't know. Explain that, how that's entertaining for the first written language. You're going to go out of the trouble to write a language, invent a language, create a written and spoken language just to make up a bullshit story about bureaucrats and inventory. Come on, man. Basically, like, they're going in and taking apart the technology. It's kind of like English and British intelligence reports after we went in and fucking took care of the Nazis and stuff. We got to, like, reverse engineer some of their shit and see what they're actually working on and the technology they're building. Also, it's probably part of the cover-up of this cosmic war as they're going through fucking causing hellfire in the sky, that they know that in the blink of a human generation, that like 100 years, like everybody we know and see and that lives on this planet will be dead and gone. But they won't be. So since they live on a much larger scale, they could hide just through that by suppressing information and hiding things. If you want an example of what I'm talking about, go look up the Secret Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Force intelligence report from November 7th, 1944, right after the war. We're basically at the end of the war when we're going in. If you want an understanding of what I'm talking about, and then translating that into a story, and tell me if you guys would watch that bullshit. Or tell this story, or pass that story on, unless it was anything but the truth, okay? Because it's not fun. It's not. I mean, you guys barely, a lot of you barely can sit and watch or find a channel like mine that actually wants to, like, explain to you and break things down into terms that most people can comprehend, and they don't even want to sit through, like, something like that because they'd rather be, you know, playing video games or occupying their time because of how society is. And the truth is so hard to get to that it disgusts people and it defers people. And once they start, change is like huge. So they, like, it's almost like the Matrix. They'll fight to stay inside of it because it's comfortable. It's what they know. They don't want to see the grimy truth. Okay. So the Allies did the same thing. We want to find out what technology they had, and we took inventory on it, and there you go. We found, like, nuclear fission reactors, rockets, and all these things that they, we wanted to find out why they were so advanced, essentially. And some of the times we just destroyed it, and other times we reverse engineered it, carted it back home, and studied it. If you go to the University of Cambridge, you can find that they put this cuneiform text, the Sumerian language, into a codex, and they give you the symbols as a key and a legend. There's at least probably 100 people in the world that fluently can read it. Fluently, as just as me and you read, but there's anybody can read it. If you have just the time and the legend, you can go through, and anybody can read these things. But they're on the University of Cambridge already translated. Not by such, and many people said such was wrong, this and that, but he's not. They're straightforward, and you translated it's a language. So when the war in Iraq started, now you could say started, but I don't think it really ever ended. This constant war has been there since, like, Sumerian times itself. But I think there's a portal or a stargate there, honestly. But the first thing they did was notify all their archaeologists of France and all these other places to come down and get your archaeologists there. And when they did, they took over the Ziggurat of Ur, which is an actual part of essentially what the Tower of Babel in the Bible. And that's what Saddam Hussein started to rebuild. That was actually part of the prophecy revelations when this tower started to be rebuilt. It would be the beginning of the end. Then we got all these artifacts, and we took the lizard creature figures, which I believe the Igigi, the dragon mothers, right, from the Sumerian texts. But if you look into it, you find out that they first thing they did was raid these museums and take all these cuneiform scripts. They took every single one of these fucking cuneiform scripts that they could out of these museums over there that were in the public, and took all the figurines, everything. I mean, they raided it, and then they took over the Ziggurat, the Tower of Babel, essentially. It's an ongoing conflict. But if you look up deep enough on the web, you'll find out the looting of the Baghdad Museum, that the Germans were actually keeping a catalog of all the artifacts they found and things that we were stealing from these museums. The entire catalog is probably on the deep web. It's not really publicly accessible, but you can actually find the paper trail and get find out that it's legitimate, but the catalog itself is actually hard to access. It's probably on the deep web if you guys know about how to search the deep web. Some of them, they literally kind of give you instructions on how to operate the stargates and the weaponry, and giving you like advanced science basically through hieroglyphs and things like that. Like if you ask a Dogon priest chief how many fundamental particles there are, it'll take 266. You ask 200 Stephen Hawking, he'll say over 200. They don't know yet, but the Dogons knew, right? And they know, and we will know very soon. So if you start looking into it, you can find out that the motivations for the war essentially were basically a battle for the technologies available to actually wage the war itself, right? And we know that there were two key fundamental principles of these weapons and this energy grid and this whole thing that they were trying to conquer and battlefield Earth. We know there was real key principles of this weaponry, right? And we'll get into that in a moment. One of them was called the Tablets of Destiny. And whoever held those had extraordinary power. It was almost the power to manifest or create anything, or it was almost like a cheat code for the Matrix, if you will. I don't know how to explain it, but it definitely had immense power, these Tablets of Destiny, whatever they were. But if you dig deep enough, you can find out the Tablets of Destiny were stole two or three different times throughout the whole history. And the first time it was stole by Tiamat and her allies, and that's what caused the original war between Marduk and Tiamat. Right, Nibiru in this planet. Okay, so there was some kind of rebellion, an off-splitting, where they ran away, stole the Tablets of Destiny, and tried to do their own thing over here. And the second one is when Anzu steals them, and then this is when actually the part where Ninurta opposes him leads to this inventory list I was talking to you about that talks about this Tablets of Destiny. Which was a pair part of this technology, whatever it was. And I think Thoth gave us a lot of hints, talking about his spaceship beneath the Sphinx and how it was a protector of the Earth, and it would, whatever the person thought, would manifest. Thinking it's something to do with that, I'm not sure though. But there's a lot in this. So they go into detail on these weapons and things that describe the manipulation of emotions, the manipulation of weather. They talk about complete and total destruction of cosmic bodies. In other words, it's like a very sophisticated, very powerful technology. Okay. So when Ninurta gets a hold of them, he does the inventory of them. He destroys some of them so they can never be used again. And the ones that cannot be destroyed, this is the cool part, maybe like kind of like something like the Emerald Tablets or something maybe totally different. But this is where it gets weird. He said he hid them, all right? And we know we're talking about Sumeria, modern-day Iraq. We've had a war there, and they're fighting over technology that is probably hidden. Stargates, archaeological digs, things like that. They probably let these other factions do the work, and then when the time came, they had to step in and take over the dig. I mean, why not? That's what we've had, constant occupation there. Okay? Occupation is not victory in any sense of the word. So why are they there? We're there for a reason. We're there to probably get this technology. And then, to take into full consideration what I'm saying, you understand that they can't lie to the people when they're doing it in choices, because they, supposedly these benevolent creatures, these like galactic federations, if you will step in and set a planet straight if something is done beyond the realm of deals forced upon them. But since our government leaders are making deals with these people, transactioning with these things, and trading technology, this, that, and the other, for safe haven here, and they rule dominion, kind of like the pyramid aspect. It's the way our government, and it's the freedom of choice, the illusion of choice. They can't lie to you completely. But we said we were looking for weapons of mass destruction, did we not? Maybe it was of a more ancient kind, okay? Maybe it was way more destructive than what we were telling people. But they were really looking for weapons of mass destruction. Think of that. I mean, think about it. Okay, so the ziggurats are always associated with these weapons of mass destruction, okay? The ziggurat of Ur, Tower of Babel, same thing. That is where Saddam Hussein lived. It was his fortress. We rebuilt it. We went there. Look up videos of the ziggurat of Ur. I have them in my playlist if you would like to look at my playlists. This is legitimate. I believe that everything I'm led to anyways has very deep-rooted truths, and I don't think that I'm very misleading at all, because they all tie together. Everything I've ever told you guys has tied right back to the same thing, right back to the same connection. And they're all from different wide variety of sources. And I always bring out that thread, okay, that other people can't see all the time. Others can and have enlightened me as well. But I believe that's the purpose, or my purpose here, is to kind of connect these thoughts for others that don't have the ability to do so. Essentially, ziggurats are pyramids. They're step pyramids. Some of them, everything we know, it's shapes, resonance, frequency, sound waves, things like that. These things were all over the place. So these were very much in tune with the weapon, the Tablet of Destiny. They were the synchronizing point. Apparently, there was a crystal on the top of the pyramid in Giza that helped battle the evil one, right? This matrix that helped awaken us to the reality of the universe and our interconnectedness, kind of stopped shutting us off and giving us a false reality, if you will, where they could hide things from your senses or things like that. Even a lot of things could go on in that sense when you understand that things are like quantum computer code. And we just invented that like in the 40s, but it's all around us. And we understand that video games, essentially, to have any kind of increase, will literally be indecipherable from reality. If there's any point of increase from right now and over the next million years, is it safe to say that somebody may be beat us to the punch, hijacked our reality, and we're kind of playing a simulation for the benefit of them through their reality? We go to work, we do this, we mine gold, essentially, we get minerals, we're just destroying and raping this earth, and they move on. This isn't their mother. The Great Pyramid itself shows signs that there's two things essentially missing from the pyramid itself. You can tell just from the structure of it. One probably being a very superconductive thing, the Ark, if you will, when they talk about them stealing the Ark and leaving, and what would cause the Egyptians, what would cause the pharaohs to actually send a whole army, his whole entire army, abandon the city to chase after them in this technology, if it wasn't worth what, you know, if it was just slaves running off into the desert to die, then why wouldn't they just let them go? Or why wouldn't he just send a battalion? Why would he send the entire army and chase them himself? If you go into the Grand Gallery, there's slots along that line the walls that go down in, and you can tell that there's something removed from those slots. Let me see if I can pull up a photo for you. Okay, so these are the slots I was talking about, right here. They go all the way up and down the Grand Gallery, and this is obviously a resonating chamber. So there's something at the bottom emitting some kind of frequency or vibration. Slots, they look like perfect fit for a tablet or some sort. Could these be the holders for the Tablets of Destiny? To further correlate this work, Chris Dunn has pretty accurately hypothesized that they were a receptacle of some kind of resonating, something that resonated some kind of frequency off, and as it went up to the Grand Gallery, the resonance, the harmonics built. And there's even a niche in the Queen's Chamber that has one of these right under the same resonant structure. If you go in there and hum, it sounds like 1,000 people are humming really loud, but it's only you. You do it in the right corner at the right octave. Everyone has a note. Every pyramid has a note. Everything was musical harmonics, essentially. So definitely had to do with dimensions, harmonics, energy, consciousness, ascension, weaponry. It was everything about the fabric of the universe itself. So we can piece together that the Tablets of Destiny and these Stones of Power were coupled together in some kind of technological fashion that created great power to the people that possessed them and held them. And the texts indicate that something was removed from the Great Pyramid, and if not, other pyramids in the region. So if you try to figure out which factions were which, you can tie them to a celestial body and things like that. So if you take Tiamat, you can go back to the Jewish word, Hebrew word Tahom, which means the waters. And you're talking about the Enumelish, you're talking about this water planet, this giant water planet that had serpents, dragons, things like that, just like the dinosaurs, like I was telling you. And the waters mingled with the Earth's waters, or the Nibiru's waters, if you will. And then when it created that, it seeded life of that kind as well. The waters mingled, it even tells you that. So some of the life from Tiamat went to here, the single-celled organisms, and some of the life from there. Essentially, when they're talking about the first collision, it could have been when the waters mingled and life began on Tiamat. And then after that, blam, the destruction and Earth, the waters carried over, the single-celled organisms, things like that, the waters mingled and life was seeded here. So you can tie that to Sitchin's readings, Thomas Mann Flanderen's readings, and many other great authors' readings and writings that they were talking about Tiamat, the planet with the great waters, the missing planet, Marduk, Krypton, which the physicist and astronomer Van Flanderen also gives evidence that Mars was probably a satellite or a moon of that planet, which explains for the very eccentric orbit when it's released from the explosion of that planet, essentially. And it also explained the hemispheric wide flooding and sloshing effect that you see on the surface of Mars. And then if you take the Greek writings, then you would have to factor in Saturn as well. And when we're talking about Saturn having these weapons and being a part of this cosmic war, you can go just look at Richard Hoagland's work, which shows you all about the satellites and how these are basically look like little Death Stars. And there's so much research just to tie into that. So just you can look up Richard Hoagland. He also did the Face on Mars and analysis of a lot of other things like that. He releases some really good info. So if you go to his website, you can look up a paper that I recommend you looking up. It's called A Moon with a View. And it's all about the moon Iapetus. It actually has a hexagonal structure. It's got straight edges. It appears to be curved from a distance, but it's kind of like a pixelized something. If you're looking at a moon or something in a video game, it's actually got curves to it. And they're straight. Curves don't, or flat lines. Flat lines do not happen in nature, especially in a vacuum. They just does not happen. So basically what they're saying is there's hexagonal features all over it. There's a ridge, actually three parallel ridges that go across the center of it, and all the craters are hexagonal. It's basically, you're looking at an artificial structure. It's a Death Star. That's no moon. So if you put them side by side, and NASA actually released this image, there's a perfect hexagonal crater. You got the ridge around the middle. There's the Death Star. George Lucas literally made it, and they made the whole Star Wars epic off of the Sumerian culture. Anu, Anakin, Luke Skywalker, that's Inki, right? The Lightbringer, Luke, light, that's the same word. And he's waking up and realizing his dad's like half robot, half machine, and da 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 da. Even Padme and Anakin, that's like You can get really deep into the Sumerian culture with that. Well, I'll just leave it at that. But, yeah, this is loaded. Star Wars, cosmic wars, essentially, this is what? Long time ago in a galaxy not so far away. But long story short is it ties Saturn in very neatly into this cosmic war and how it's itself and its satellites and its moons were involved in this war. Okay. So what I'm going to do is make this part one, because I'm getting a little long-winded here. I'm going to go ahead and do part two, and we'll go on. There's a lot more information to go over to give you a background. I'll be uploading them today and just giving you a nice interval to leave off. I'll pick right up where I left off here, so please watch this one first. Okay. Thank you, and enjoy part two.